What we're going to do is, Bill and I will both write down to make sure we capture everything, but, you know, coming back together and sort of to reflect on it as a large group now, what struck you, what values resonate with you? What are your personal experiences, community values, and how they impact this task force? Just spit it out. What struck you?
So, a couple of things, and where are we? And over here. Oh, yes. So, I just want to give you a great big shout out because he's been involved in land preservation in the town. And one of the things he said is, you know, the woods, loves the woods, the natural landscape. Am I speaking correctly for what you said? And I just thought that is definitely one thing, is that there's a real sense of land conservation and protecting it from development, you know, and that it's kind of different than what we're talking about here. But I do really think that that is, you know, a sense of keeping things preserved in their natural state. I think that is a huge value.
Okay. Yeah, I'm telling Lisa's story, actually, because I was really impressed by her. She moved on many times before first grade, and then her mom said, we're buying a house to settle down, which was in Greenville. And her father was an ex-con, and her mother said, we're buying a house, you can leave if you want, but we're buying a house, we're staying in one place.
Was that your she told your father?
Yes, this is all her story. And so her dad stayed and got employed and learned how to stay employed, which had been an issue before, and developed from being, progressed from being an ex-con, you know, difficult person, to being, you said, an MIT
lecturer
in his field. I mean, just settling down and having a house, an affordable house, literally changed the life of that family.
Thanks for sharing. And thanks for that. I'm pretty sure.
Whether we fit into a more rural category or a more suburban category, because sense of other people's mothers were looking out for you, like that sense of community in that way that you had many mothers on the block that, you know, if you did something wrong, your mother knew by the time you got home. So that, you know, that sense of being part of something bigger and that sense of community.
Yeah. A word that was brought up and I think is perfect for what we're talking about is connectedness. We all felt that we were really connected, family, friends, community. And that was really important. Here or everywhere that he was when we were kids. But it was also one of our values for us.
So that's why you
need to. Yes.
Carter and I both grew up in Peterborough, Phil. So what I was glad since I grew up a few years before Carter did, so I was glad to hear that that he had some of those same impressions. Is growing up here in Peterborough as a child, you were it wasn't just that you attended Children in the Arts or attended the 4th of July celebration or as a child, were expected to participate. You were part of the success of the events in this child. When you had a voice or something to say at the table, your voice was important. When I was growing up here, I would get a call from somebody here at the Historical Society, and they would say, it wouldn't be my mother, it wouldn't be my grandmother, it wouldn't be anybody that I knew except as Mrs. Blair, who worked at the Historical Society, and she would say, well, Heather, you can either dip candles on the 4th of July celebration, or you can make yarn dolls. Which would you like to do?
Which was
I dip candles. But in other words, even as a child here, you have a responsibility for the success of what goes on in the town. And even when my bicycling, my son would still have to bicycle from East Mountain Road to Summer Street to see his good friend, and then he would hang out at his friend's house and so that his mom would drive him home because it's uphill all the way back up to East Mountain Road. But they still have it, but they also had the responsibility that, that they had to be part of what was happening in this town. It wasn't just that they go play video games. They were picking up trash by the road. They were working on the wood storage for the gym.
Wood bed.
Right. Exactly. And again, it would be Jim Orr would sit home and say, "Hey, I need some help." It wouldn't be their father or teacher. It would be some other adult who would say, "Hey, you know, if you guys got some time and need some help at the wood bank, and they would bike over and do it.
Sarah brought up when we got into our group of six, the volunteers that we have in this town. Everybody here volunteers on something. So I was just thinking, Heather, as you're saying that, we can probably call someone and say, okay, which board, which community do you want?
Yeah, exactly.
A recycling center or maybe concert. That's a good technique. Just don't give them that.
Yeah, there was also something that I've same group as Heather. There was something else that came up in our group in response to the last question, which was us basically trying to define or understand the concept of preserve. Because that was the word that was chosen for that last question, but Sarah brought up that she felt like preserve can kind of make things be stagnant or keep them from growing or changing. And that resonated with me a lot, and it made me think, like, when I consider preservation or the preservation of the community, it's not so much about specific tangible things. You know, like, there's plenty of new architecture plans that I've seen that I think would look great in town. You know, we don't have to stick to old style buildings. That's just one example, but the idea being, what I would want to preserve about the area is not anything specific that I can see or touch. It's about the connectedness. It's everything that we just talked about right here that makes this, that sets this community apart. What Heather was just talking about, that, you know, for kids, letting children participate and feel equal in that situation, feel invited in. You know, I wrote that.
That doesn't sound like Heather was invited.
Well, the idea is like, growing up, there was an aspect of participatory involvement as opposed to spectatorial, a spectatorship type involvement, where, you know, like, I know a lot of people that grew up and they're like, okay, kids need to just be quiet and sit and listen and learn, and that wasn't how it was here.
You weren't there to be entertained, you were there to.
Right, we were there to be a part of things. And Tyler mentioned something about his son having similar experiences growing up. And so that just made me think of preservation as not a building or not a street or not curb cuts or whatever, but
an ethic.
Yeah, it's that underpinning there. So.
We have to move on. These are really helpful. And I think these are the types of things that we'll continue to come back to. And I think these are the types of memories and thoughts. I mean, one thought I've heard of, my own upbringing was the dinner bell. Mm-hmm. You know, my mother rang a bell and you came home. Mm-hmm. You know? And then the other part was the statement that you don't go, like, kids don't show up at someone else's house anymore. Like, my child doesn't show up at your house, I'm not going to say, where's my friend who lives in this house? You know, there's this planning prospect of what, like, we have to plan a play date instead of, like,
yeah, video.
You just show up at someone's house and say, I'm here to see your son, where is he?
You know, I have kids of that age and they don't need to now because they just text each other and say, where are we? They don't need to come and knock on the door.
Yeah. So it's interesting, but I like the concept that you've just introduced of how you preserve that ethic.
Mm-hmm. I have a question on that. And it really, if I may, it's a difference between a suburban and a rural area. And you know, while our kids, while growing up, rode their bikes a lot, when my son was very young, I lived in a very rural be 10 minutes sometimes for his best friend to come over by car. So his mother wasn't going to do that unless she called me first to make sure everything was home, right? But so when you live in a more suburban area where you can walk and bike and, oh, I'm going to stop in and see Ethan, or I'm going to go up and visit Parker, maybe not so much. Peter, he was up on the hill.
Yeah, you know. But he used to bike down.
Yeah, but you used, you know, where it's a more suburban and compact, like in the downtown, I can see that kind of connectivity, but not in my mind, in a truly rural area. We are
we're going to do is we're going to have a little bit of an activity. Kristen's going to help us think of things to move in a different way for a moment. Maybe, is that fair to say?
Sure. Everybody stand up. All right. So this theme can be referred to as many things. I usually call it Samurai. So they will have four moves in this game. So everybody clap your hands together. Go up, and every time you move, we say walk. Ready? So go up, walk.
Walk.
Go down, walk.
Walk.
Go to the side, walk.
Walk.
Go to the other side,
walk.
Perfect. So how this works. Somebody go down, walk, and look right in the eye while we say it. Libby, you want to do it? Is this right across from me?
Walk.
Perfect. So that's going to be the first move that sets it up, and you have to look the person in the eye because there's a lot of people. And so the second I receive it, I go walk, I put my hands up. So then the people on either side of me have to pay attention, because if my hands go up, their next move is to both come at me and chop me.
Walk.
Is that right?
Awesome. It's a game.
Perfect. And so that is the completion. So then I have my hands up, I'll pass to Karen, walk.
Walk.
And you go up.
So it's down,
so,
up, sorry. Okay.
Yep, so you go up, and then on the other side, you go in. Perfect.
And then down.
Yeah, and then you go back down. Ready? So we'll practice for a little bit.
Oh,
and if you might not get
the next person. And how does the next person go?
Yeah.
You choose. You choose.
And I choose the next person.
Yep,
and
you choose down.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. So I'll start again. Ready? And walk.
Walk.
Yep.
Say walk. Say
walk.
Walk.
Walk. Perfect.
Walk.
Okay.
Walk. Walk.
And you have to say walk.
Walk. Walk. And you do it.
And now you gotta look somebody in the eye and pass.
Walk.
Walk.
Really?
Wah!
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 Wah!